James Adams is a sporty guy who likes to be the leader of the group. James has super spy goggles that can zoom in on things over 1 mile away and can pick up on sounds from 2 kilometres away. James is normally in a leather jacket. He also has a techie watch that can tell you the weather and time all over the world. James can sometimes get quite bossy.
Ellie Madison is an over-organised control freak who packs everything. She is a charitable and a determined girl who is persistent in all that she does. You can rely on her to pack everything for you. She knows a lot about countries, especially Colombia. She has auburn-coloured hair. She always wears purple headphones with classic music coming out to calm herself down. She's always texting, and she wears a bright orange neon hoodie.
Leo is an intelligent and clever agent who is very nerdy and techie. He is sharp, kind and responsible, but he has a rubbish dress sense. He always wears the same orange shorts and an orange t-shirt. He has a cream waistcoat and loves to read about history.
Unbeknown to the CCK, a letter was winging its way by jet across the Atlantic. It arrived in the country, and then by truck, and by van, and by a postman wearing slightly purpley looking trousers and looking far too happy with his lot. It arrived at the headquarters of the CCK in London town, just waiting to be opened.
Was that a knock at the door?
I think it was.
Delivery for the CCK for Master Adams.
Thank you. My name is Leonardo Vaquay, and I'm an esteemed film producer from the historical city of Rome.
Wow.
You may know me, my first film was awarded a Best Newcomer Prize at the Berlin's Film Festival. Subsequently, I featured in many leading publications discussing my interest in explorers of the past.
Sounds like quite a character.
Yeah.
My next adventurous project is a film about the first intrepid explorers of El Dorado, Luis and Solomon. The success of my film will depend on the information that only can be uncovered from the access to the documents, diaries and artefacts of their quest. I understand that, as a descendant of Solomon Clegg, that you will not only have these items or their replicas in your possession, but would wish to help uncover the truth about what really happened all those years
ago.
Wow. Ooh. Okay, let's have a read. My company plan to meet you in the hot, busy Sao Paulo on February 22nd, and we would very much like to meet you and examine the old precious documents you're able to bring.
Wow.
Okay. Goes without saying that we will pay for your expenses and give you a percentage of any profit the film makes.
Cool.
Maybe, if we're lucky, you could have a share of the gold itself.
Huh.
Oh, cool. I enclose a ticket for a flight to Sao Paulo as a sign of goodwill. Yours sincerely, Leonardo Vaquay.
Wow, guys, it looks like we've got a big adventure up ahead. Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
So our intrepid investigators headed for Sao Paulo, which, as you know, is in Brazil. Despite this film being set in Colombia. Who teaches them geography at this place?
Can I just say I did not teach 5W geography this year.
So they quickly changed planes and headed off to Colombia, to Cartagena, the city where their adventure would truly begin.
Hi, Dari. Amazed, excited and slightly overwhelmed, I got off the Airbus A380 jumbo jet. The heat of the Colombian air hit us as we got off the plane. We had no idea of where to go, but of course Ellie had brought a map which we followed out of the airport.
We got a cab through the busy traffic to our hotel. The sounds, smells and atmosphere of the city filled our senses. I feasted off the pure essence of city life, exhaust fumes, noise and colour.
We arrived at our very posh hotel with its marble floors and really high ceilings. Leo couldn't resist taking photos all the time. Mr. Vaquaz had clearly spent a lot of money on keeping us comfortable.
We quickly got ready and couldn't wait to get out and explore Cartagena. We headed for the hustling and bustling market. Street sellers and stall holders flogging oranges, pears, grapes and all sorts of multicoloured fruit were everywhere, making it almost impossible to avoid bumping and bashing into people. It was lovely.
Today was horrific. We were kidnapped. It all started after we had caught the train to Jimenez Studios to film the documentary. The last thing I remember was getting a drink from the trolley. The lady that was pushing the trolley smelt like a pair of pants that had not been washed for 3 weeks. She looked like a wrinkly cabbage, but I was very surprised how nice she was, though when she asked if we wanted a cup of smelly tea. She was sort of shoving it into our hands, so we had to drink it. The tea tasted like mouldy slugs and gave me the shivers.
Oh.
Moments later, we were confused, dizzy, startled. Everything was black. The tea must have had a sleeping potion in it. I was so annoyed. That cup of mouldy tea was 125 pesos, which Ellie found this out in the horrid, stinky, rank and revolting smell.
Crack! The sound of the electric current. The pain was excruciating. It was worth 3 hours of my life. We had been chained to the wall, and we get 5 volts of electricity every 10 seconds. The cuffs were so tight they dug into our wrists. The cell was horrid, with cockroaches scuttling everywhere, the walls covered in mould and the dried blood of previous occupants. We then heard the unusual sound of an electric motor, and to our horror, we could see the floor opening and a pool of piranhas waiting to be fed. It was at this point that we knew we were going to die. They obviously wanted to know about our mission, and that it was something to do with gold, but we didn't know what. The only thing to do was think of a plan, and quick. I'm in a dark, dingy and abandoned cell. I'm trapped in this awful place, feeling confused, shocked, scared, and worrying about what may happen. By now, I'd had enough. I couldn't stand it anymore, so I decided to escape. Whilst I was sitting on the cold, wet and dark floor with my sore hands chained to the wall, I remembered that my right earring, which is a bit of tech that, when pressed, activates my watch missile launcher. I pointed it at my chains, twisted the top and waited. Small pieces of chains blew everywhere. We weren't sure what to do next. When we heard the key in the door turning, oh no! The guards had heard us, but it wasn't a guard, but a tall, dark figure who told us he had come to help us. He said that he had drugged the guard outside our cell and pinched the keys from his pocket and had to let us out. We dashed outside and a taxi drove past. We called it over and they asked for 250 peso. Our hearts still racing, we jumped in, and I was so relieved to be away from that awful place. He had given us a map and told us that we had to find the wisest man in Colombia who would help us with the next part of our quest.
The wind was howling, but our detective stood powerfully, like mountains, with an aura you would expect from a top team of detectives. Persistent, unwavering, resolute, they were determined to find the wisest man in Colombia and uncover the mystery of El Dorado. What really happened all those years ago between those two great explorers, Solomon Clegg and Luis Jimenez? A tropical storm created a kaleidoscopic cacophony of light and sound as the sun played hide and seek amongst the clouds and the leaves of the tree canopy above. Our detectives marched through the storm like an immortal, well-disciplined Roman army. But was the army as disciplined as it first looked, as Ellie stood clearly upset and begging to be hypnotized to overcome her fear of travelling on water?
I don't want to get in that boat! My favourite water will never leave me! Never! Now, what's the worst thing that's going to happen to you? It's not like you're going to fall into the water, is it?
How long is this going to take? We have a mystery to solve and we are wasting time. Can I just hurry up with that watch?
Finally, the hypnosis seemed to work and Ellie and the other two climbed into the boat. James was going to do the pedaling as they eventually started to drift down the mighty Amazon River. He kept an eye on the map they had been given in Cartagena, whilst the others used their tech in the back of the boat.
Look at those gigantic trees! We must be getting close to the jungle, where you can set up camp. I can't wait to get back on the on land. What's that in the dark and dingy water? Oh, never mind. It's probably just a bit of weed. Let's not worry, we've passed it now. Carry on pedaling, James.
I'm determined to get us there, but it is hard work. I'm following this map, and hopefully your tech will make sure we don't get lost.
The team showed great determination in the face of the colossal Amazon rainforest. To keep their spirits up, they sang the cheery song Ten Green Bottles, whilst Ellie and Leo fished for food off the side of the boat.
10 green bottles hanging on a wall. 10 green bottles.
Hard work. We must be getting close now. Can't you hear the sound of jungle creatures up ahead?
It has worked. I feel relaxed. I want to keep singing that song. 8 green bottles hanging on a wall. 8
green bottles. Be quiet, Ellie. You've heard it enough. I'm starving and I can't wait to eat that lovely fish we caught earlier.
Hot, humid, sticky, the three detectives continued on their journey. James's legs were getting tired from powering the bicycle boat. The massive trees were now towering high above them, reflecting a green tinge onto their faces. Suddenly, Ellie spots something and points.
What's that moving in the water? Did anyone else see it?
I'm exhausted. My legs are so tired. Just a minute, we're about to crash into some very big looking reeds.
Whoa! James, you said that a bit late. We are already stuck.
Ellie was still trying to figure out what that strange-looking thing was. Was it a creature that she thought had popped out of the water? She started to go through some suggestions.
Well, it could have been a lizard, or a snake, or a caiman. Look over there.
I think she's right. It's that fearsome-looking Amazon crocodile, also known as a caiman.
We're stuck fast. What are we going to do?
Hold still. It looks hungry. Quick, let's throw this fish into the water and hope it's tastier than us.
I think it's eating it.
Yeah, it's doing the trick. Well done, Ellie. That quick thinking did the trick.
What a relief. I didn't fancy wrestling with a caiman.
When they eventually untangled the boat from the reeds, they finally reached the shore. Exhausted, they stretched themselves out on the muddy banks of the riverbank, the tall, majestic trees towering above them as they lay there, tired and relieved to be back on dry land.
That was too close. Let's not do that again.
I'm with you on that one.
Count me in on that. Ellie?
Yes?
You reacted so quickly to that caiman attack. How did you do it?
Just instinct, I guess.
The three detectives squelched through the warm but wet mud of the rainforest floor, trying to find a suitable spot to set up camp. They needed to rest their poor, aching legs. Clutching their machetes, they hacked through the dense foliage. Suddenly, James tripped over a large tree root.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
fine.
Well, you stumbled in a perfect place, as it's a bit of a clearing.
What do you mean?
Well, it's a perfect place to build a camp.
Well, we better get on with it. But it'll soon be dark, and I'm starving!
James was starving after all his pedalling and walking, and he suddenly ate the last of their supplies as quickly as a wolf's dinner. He grabbed the food and quickly gobbled it down.
Hey! What was that for?
I'm so sorry, guys, but I'm absolutely starving.
Well, what are you going to eat now? You know we had to throw the fish we caught into the river to get that crocodile thing away from us.
It wasn't a crocodile. It wasn't a crocodile. It was a caiman.
Whatever.
Leo and James set off to do some hunting in the thick forest, armed only with sharpened wooden sticks and a couple of penknives. They looked for anything that was remotely edible.
I've got you, you stupid jaguar! Die!
Ellie was feeling sick from hunger and exhaustion, so stayed at camp. She vomited against a very old and dishevelled tree. Feeling better, she headed for a local stream to get water and hopefully catch more fish. After a while, the three detectives arrived back at camp with their catches. Sweat was dripping from their foreheads as the humid air spread across their faces. Ellie was already back and had started cooking the fish.
This smells delicious.
Ellie, we've got some meat! What did you get?
I caught some piranha.
We're only a piranha. We got a jaguar.
Shut up, Leo. Ellie has done quite well. And plus, the fish smells delicious.
It's unusually cold and foggy as the detectives pack up their tents and continue on their way. The fog had made it impossible to follow their maps, and they had been walking slowly around in circles for ages. Their feet were covered in thick, sticky mud, and it was all over them. Before long, they had arrived back at the camp where they had stayed the night before.
Oh!
I've got mud all over me!
Oh, please stop moaning, Ellie. This is an adventure!
Great, we're back at camp. Oh, brilliant. Twelve and James, your amazing math skills have led us back to where we started.
It's not my fault this fog is so thick. And my mapping skills aren't that great. That GPS on your wrist isn't much better.
Oh, guys, stop moaning.
Guys, look, there's smoke rising above the treetops. There must be someone there. Maybe they can help us find our way. Let's go.
The three detectives headed west towards the smoke. The sticky jungle leaves towered above them as they walked on through the jungle. In the distance, they could hear the rippling water of the Amazon flowing downstream.
We should be getting close now, because I can smell burning firewood a lot stronger than usual.
Yep. This must be it, because on the map at the end of the trail there are pictures of round huts.
Why don't we have a look in one and see if anyone's in? How about that one?
Seems empty. Let's go.
Wait, I think there's somebody in that big chair over there.
As they looked around the room, the smell of firewood was really strong. A little light was coming from two small windows and the open doorway. It was a good place for the three detectives to cool down away from the heat of the now burning sun outside. It was a very strange, yet calm and still. The only noise came from the man humming to himself.
Looking at that chair, I think that's the chief.
Hello, please make yourself comfortable. I heard you arrive. My tribe have been watching you as you walked. My power tells me that you are looking for the wisest person in all of Columbia. Would you like directions?
Yes, please.
If you have a compass, you have to have a mile north and then a mile northwest.
How long will it take, Mr. Chief?
Well, if you don't follow that man, then it should take you about 45 minutes.
Thank you, Chief. We'll be off now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Brilliant.
They're never gonna make it.
The sticky heat was getting worse. The deafening noise of crickets filled their sunburnt ears as they arrived at the village of the wisest person in Columbia. They slowly entered their second jungle dwelling in the same day. The place looked deserted, except for a few chairs and a table covered in strange-looking food. There was a small fire burning in the centre of the room, with what looked like dead spiders hanging over it. Was that someone lurking in the shadows?
Over there! In the shadows! I'm sure it's a man. He's pretty scary.
Oh, come on! Really? Only a man. It's a bit whiffy.
James is right. Listen to this. Hello, we've come to see you.
What do you want from me?
The detectives explained their whole story so far, about their mission to make a documentary about El Dorado and the explorers Solomon Clegg and Louis Jimenez and their feud 500 years ago, them being kidnapped and then escaping with the help of a mystery person in a dark suit, and him giving them a map into the jungle, and the chief who showed them the way to the wisest man in Colombia. The old man listened quietly to everything that the young detectives had to say. Behind him, a huge spider was also listening.
Our adventure started when we received a mysterious letter to research some information for a film based on El Dorado, produced by Jimenez Studios. In our second day, we were kidnapped and spent 2 days in a prison cell. Is that a spider?
Leo, it's only a spider. Until a person in a black suit rescued us, gave us a map and told us to come and see you.
We had to paddle boat all the way up the River Amazon, avoiding a close call with a caiman, and then trek through the rainforest to get here.
On all the information you have told me, you will need to leave my village and head for a sacred place known as Lake Guatavita.
Thank you. What is it?
This is a map that, if you read correctly, will lead you to Lake Guatavita and the secret city of El Dorado, the lost city of gold.
Did you hear that, James? Read correctly.
Okay, no time for jokes. We'd better be on our way. We don't have all the time in the world.
Bye.
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 Goodbye and good luck. You're going to need it.
The beautiful rainforest. Those are the only words to describe the ginormous tangle of trees and vines, flooded with colours of dark and light, littered with animals big and small. The three detectives were slowly making their way through the crunchy leaves and vines that they had to trample all over to make their way through.
In the distance was a vast barren hill with mosses and strange fungi appearing on trees.
After being violently sunburnt, the detectives were carelessly wandering through the jungle, avoiding the scorching rays of sunlight here and there, because the trees weren't large enough to block the sun.
Ellie rose from the floor of the small clearing, trudging off into the distance and beckoning the others to follow her.
Their view was like a rainbow of nature. The colourful animals were running and flying all around them.
As the three marvellous detectives struggled through the everlasting emerald green rainforest, they had to stop to catch their breath.
They could hear the squelching of the mud beneath their feet and could see the bright green leaves.
Slide trudging down the rocky dirt slope to the vast beach.
The beautiful gold sand covered James's body as he lay down. Crouching beside him, Leo watched the setting sun glowing like a nightlight.
As Leo looked over his shoulder, he saw an old woman about the age of 92 throwing gold into the lake. Leo slowly picked up a gold coin and heard a voice.
The wise woman was greeting them whilst chucking gold into the lake. Tired, hungry and anxious, they listened to the small woman telling them the truth of El Dorado.
They were now talking to the old woman. They were confused, shocked and devastated after the trio had found out the truth. The woman explained that there was no lost city of gold and it was just a myth.
James felt annoyed, Leo felt confused and Ellie was gobsmacked. The truth had been told, there was just a beautiful lake. There was still gold though, but it was an offering for the sun god. Her eyes full of tears, Ellie argued to the elderly woman that it couldn't be possible.
James's face was full of anger, his hands were clenched and he was sweating. Sorrowful, downcast and dejected, the detectives sagged to the ground. If the lost city of gold had been real, if they had won the fortune, then the trio wouldn't have been so devastated.
Wow, that was an adventure. Imagine going all the way to Lake Gratavita and there wasn't even any gold.
I know.
I really want to clear my family name after all these years and it's been a myth.
Guys, what about we go back to Cartagena and we confront him and Ez's granddaughter and tell them it was just a myth all those years ago?
Good idea.
Cool, let's do that then.
Come on, let's go.
A quick trek back through the jungle to the local airport meant they were on a plane heading back to Cartagena to confront the Jimenez family and clear the name of Solomon Clegg.
Look guys, we've got to be undercover. There are loads of Jimenez's guards patrolling everywhere, checking there's nothing weird going on.
Hey guys, I've got a great suggestion. Let's brand you with a carnival.
Great idea, Ellie. Look, there's the carnival.
Recognize you now, Leo.
Quick, we need to get a taxi. Taxi!
Gringos, put your seatbelts on in my car.
Where do you tourists want to go?
Do you know the way to the Jimenez house?
Miss Jimenez? You don't want to go there. She's a bad lady.
I'm sure we can look after ourselves.
How long will it take?
The way I drive? 5 minutes.
Leo, do you have the Colombian papers yet?
They're all in my bag. No need to worry.
reckon?
Looks like we're arriving. I can see the guards over there.
Okay, pulls in. We're here. 100 pesos.
There you go, 100 pesos. I hope it's enough.
I'll keep the change. Good luck.
Thanks. Thanks. Thank you.
They're in for some trouble.
Our three detectives approached the home of Miss Jimenez. The guards looked menacing on the gate as they patrolled backwards and forward. Our three detectives approached them with a little bit of anxiety. The guards approached the detectives. They asked, "Have you got permission to see Miss Jimenez? Have you got the papers?" Fortunately, Leo produced the papers. These were rigorously checked at gunpoint. As they carried on, the guards agreed to let them through and into the compound where the Jimenez family lived. Our three detectives of the CCK entered the compound. Was this going to be their doom?
Hey guys, look, the guards are there.
How are you feeling?
A bit nervous.
Remember the CCK motto. No pain.
No fear.
No regrets. Let's do this for Solomon Clegg.
Hey.
Miss Jimenez is expecting me. By the way, she prefers not to shake her hand.
Hi guys, Martin Scorsese here, and it's at this point I gotta make a note of Mr. Worthington's directing skills. After all the children's hard work of recording their script, the numpty forgot to turn on a microphone on the camera. So you gotta put up with his boring accent narrating over the top of the video footage. He ain't gonna win an Oscar for this.
Thanks for that, Mr. Scorsese. Much appreciated. Anyway, the trio entered the home of the Jimenez family, where they explained to the great times 8 granddaughter of Luis Jimenez that the story of the gold was all actually a myth. The Cleggs had never taken the gold in the first place. In fact, it hadn't existed. Her bitter rivalry was false. She didn't believe them. And so she set her guards onto our three detectives, determined once and for all to rid the world of the family Clegg. And so the chase began.
Them.
They're heading for it.
Well, they can't get out of there. Let's go corner them.
Quick!
Look, a den!
Come on!
Oh, come on, quick!
Where should we hide?
Quick, they're going over there! Over there! Quick!
We've got them now.
They're never going to escape.
What are we going to do? They're coming.
Oh my gosh.
They're just over there.
This is their last day here.
What should we do?
I don't know.
We've got them now.
No fear.
Nice knowing you guys.
Bye.
No fear. No pain. No regret.
More like lots of pain, lots of fear.
Lots of regret.
Of regrets.
Wait, Leo, what about that watch? Doesn't it still have that missile thing on it?
Give me a minute.
Oh, quickly.
My God, you've killed my God!
Wait, the gun!
No, please!
I'm sure they'll believe our story.
And I'm sure glad that we cleared my family name.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm almost pretty sure we deserve a nice flight home.
Yeah.